Yes, tonight we have our symposium, the Mary Kalopothakis event, where we are sponsoring, or rather highlighting, breast cancer awareness, and new technologies in that field. Our honoree tonight is Dr. Tousimis. She is going to tell us about the status of affairs with breast cancer surgeries and some of the things that she sees in her practice in Washington, D.C. We also have a lovely speaker, Dr. Andriopoulou, who will tell us some of the biological advances in breast cancer, and we also have a talk from Dr. John Melnick and the state of affairs with MRIs and breast cancer. We're very excited to hear what they have to say and look forward to it. I want to personally thank Dr. Spiros Mazitis, who's the president of the Federation of Hellenic Societies here in New York. We had a press conference 2 days ago, and the president of the Athenian Medical Society, Dr. Patoulas, joined us, where we highlighted what all of the different federations and Hellenic societies of either educational or geographical associations met. Everyone apparently is very excited to help. Everyone apparently is very enthusiastic, but some ideas were shared, some plans were made for the future, and I think that's where the importance lies. We are all very, very intent on helping our mother country, and the importance is that we do it together, that we don't waste time, and that we try to limit our obstacles. It was a wonderful event, and we look forward to this being the platform for the future where things can actually get done. Another sponsor of this event, I'm going to introduce them now. Let me first introduce Dr. Sotirios Sergiopoulos, whom I know very well and love, and thank you for introducing them to us. We hope to collaborate further, and thank you for helping us sponsor this, but we hope to actually be able to help you guys as well. That's the kind of thing that this is exactly the kind of thing that we look forward to working more with.
So I've had the pleasure over the past, couple of years of running into a wonderful family at my local Church of Resurrection. Unbeknownst to me is that they had a great effort in their foundation trying to help women with breast cancer in many different ways, supporting research or many others. And being myself involved as the head of breast cancer for Celgene Corporation in the U.S., I found this as a wonderful opportunity for them to come out and maybe say a couple of words about themselves and also have you all know who they are. So if there's any question or concern, anything that you want to be able to ask them, they'll be here. So let me first introduce Destiny Yeri from the Cat's Ribbon of Hope.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much. We are, Katerina and I are honored to be here this evening. And just a brief little overview of what we have done. Katerina will introduce herself in a few moments, but my sister Katerina was diagnosed with breast cancer at the age of 32 3 years ago. And after countless surgeries and trying time in her life, we decided to take something very horrible and turn it into something very good. And what we do is we started a breast cancer foundation in Long Island called the Cat's Ribbon of Hope Foundation. And our main mission is to help women with disparities face their troubles and to obtain treatment, whether it's through a patient navigator at Delphi University or to get treatment at North Shore Hospital. We also fund clinical trials at Memorial Sloan Kettering. We're looking to broaden our horizons, which is why we're here. So it's a pleasure to be here, and thank you for having us.
That was very inspiring. I think as physicians, this is really the purpose of our work, to improve the lives of patients, and it's very inspiring that an illness can really spur such interest and support, and maybe, you know, hopefully something good will come out. So I hope everybody looks to ways that not only through research, which we'll be speaking through, medical advances, patient advocacy is a very important component. So I'm Dr. Lynn Barris Stella. I'm a radiation oncologist at NYU, and I've treated patients with breast cancer for many years, although now I focus in gynecologic cancers. Our topic for this, as an introduction, is to speak about women in medicine and the career of medicine as a career for women, which faced a lot of difficulties when we were starting out in this field. This annual symposium, it's an honor to see it continue every year. It was founded 4 years ago, and now we have Dr. Tasimis again. She was at our inaugural lecture at that time of Memorial, and it's dedicated to the women who were barred from medicine and to the women who, despite barriers, succeed and excel in medicine. And I think our panelists today are a fine example of that. We all see in all our paperwork, the Hellenic Medical Society and Asclepius, but also there's a female component because the daughters of Asclepius were female. And Hygieia and Asclepius shown here, there was a component of healing that was attributed to women even in ancient Greece. The name of this symposium is for Mary Kalopothakis, who was the first Greek-American female physician. She was born in Athens in 1859. And she was the daughter of Michael Kalopothakis, a medical doctor in Athens, and Maria Hooper Blackler from Marblehead, Massachusetts. She studied in Greek and American schools and actually attended the Harvard Annex, now Radcliffe College. She wanted to study medicine, but no women were allowed to enter the Greek medical schools at the time, so she had to go to Paris, France, where she pursued her studies in medicine. And in 1886, she obtained her medical degree and began practicing in pediatrics, gynecology, and then returned to Greece and had to start training nurses because there was not nurses at the time. There were no nurses employed in Greece at the time, so she had to train. There was the Greco-Turkish War of 1897, and she worked as director and even as surgeon for the Red Cross. This is from the archives, and you see the Red Cross in her medical equipment that she would take to the front. At the end of the war, the Union of Greek Women recognized that she organized, directed, was recognized by Florence Nightingale, the English nurse, who made a lot of contributions in the knowledge and improvement of public health at the time. She opened a clinic for women and children and trained nurses, focusing on prevention of public health and infections such as tuberculosis, and also worked full-time as a pediatrician. She was a modest and a humanitarian. Here she is pictured with a British nurse on the left. She was recognized by Her Majesty Queen Olga for her efforts in 1898. And a contemporary had written of her altruistic character that she's a saint because not only does she not take money for the poor, but she pays for the medication from her own pocket. So that was Maria Kalopothakis, and we're honored to have her name for this symposium. And just to speak a little bit about the efforts of women in this specialty, in 2009, half of newly minted physicians are female. However, in 1969, that figure was fewer than 1 in 10. So there is a changing face of medicine. The timeline of women in medicine starts in the US from 1847. And you can put on the timeline within that same century, Maria Kalopothakis also finished. So she was really an early contemporary of the founding female physicians of the United States as well. The percentage of US medical school applicants and graduates who are female has been rising, and by 2006, 50% of medical students and 15% of full-time professors are female. So in terms of academic ranks, we still have a long way to go to have equal representation. However, there is a consistent rise in parity, at least among medical students at this time. In the NIH, though, recognize that the advancement of women has potential barriers, and they published a report in 2006, a working group that be trying to improve the potential of women in academic sciences. And so there are efforts to try to improve the advancement of women in academic centers professionally that in all career stages in the universities and other funding agencies. So how can we make a difference? We can encourage girls to pursue careers of science and math. We can honor accomplishments of past and present female physicians and scientists, and this symposium does that. And I think for the Hellenics, for our ethnic denomination, it is an important step to acknowledge females of Hellenic descent and their contributions. And the NIH is collecting biographies of women who are successful in medicine, and it would be, I think, for especially for our panelists and other females that we have had the pleasure of lecturing, it would be nice for them to be included at the NIH site. And it all goes down, in my thoughts, I think it goes down to mentorship. There is a paternal but also a maternal example of mentorship, and we need to work together to advance for the advancement and professional advancement of both male and female Greek American youth. And I think that academic success in the future of our children is not a private family matter, but a global Hellenic concern. And it's something that we can all contribute and help by acknowledging the accomplishments that Hellenic physicians have managed to not only in this country, but internationally, and giving recognition for the accomplishments that Greeks make both abroad and in Greece, which there's a lot of excellent physicians in Greece as well that need to be recognized. And I also wanted to give some credit to the professional organizations, female professional organizations like Arabo, but also the Hellenic Professional Women, who make a big difference, also including not only at times of physicians, but also giving recognition for women that are excelling in other fields like law, medicine, science, in research and others. So I think we can all support one another, and I think it's very important to give acknowledgement for all those efforts. Thank you for your time. And so we hope to have another session. Dr. Ndoukou will give an introduction for Dr. Toussinis,
for a very special woman, a very special physician surgeon, and a close friend, Dr. Eleni Toussinis. This event is to pay tribute to the generations of women of Hellenic descent whose commitment to humanity in all aspects of life across community, service, arts, science, medicine came to bear as an invaluable contribution to our society. It took a long way and we're not quite there yet, but no doubt women have advanced in several extraordinary leadership roles. Certainly, we have achieved unprecedented power and influence in shaping the future in all sectors, including many influential women in politics, economics, science, medicine, and also charity. And at this point, I would like to congratulate the Cats Ribbon Foundation initiative. It is something that we really need in order to advance research in medicine. Our honoree for tonight, Dr. Eleni Toussinis, was born and raised in Washington, D.C., and has recently returned to the area after 25 years. She's a board-certified general surgeon who is a nationally renowned specialist in breast cancer surgery. In 2012, she joined MedStar Georgetown University Hospital, Lombardi Comprehensive Cancer Center, as the director of the Orisman Breast Center, chief of the Division of Breast Surgery, and fellowship director of the Breast Oncology Fellowship Program in Washington, D.C. Dr. Toussinis attended Ivy League, Dartmouth, and Mount Holyoke College, where she graduated cum laude. She then received her medical degree from Albany Medical College, following her breast surgery fellowship training at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York City. She completed additional specialty training in minimally invasive surgery of breast at the European Institute of Oncology in Milan, Italy, mentored by a trailblazer in the field, Dr. Professor Roberto Veronese. For nearly 10 years, Dr. Toussinis was an associate professor of clinical surgery at Weill Cornell Medical College and at New York Presbyterian Hospital, and served as an associate program director of surgical education. She has been recognized for her advanced surgical techniques, cosmetic outcomes. I have to tell you, I'm witnessing this every single day. I have seen dozens of her patients, and I should tell you that at least 5 minutes of my encounter with these patients are praises from her patients for Dr. Toussinis. She pursued new initiatives in breast cancer management, including nipple-sparing mastectomy, partial breast irradiation, and new anesthetic techniques that decrease pain after breast surgery and result in better outcomes, paying tribute to the initial healers. This is something that identifies with Hellenism from the very, very first seminal steps and the initiation of medicine. As a well-respected clinician, researcher, and teacher, Dr. Toussinis holds several leadership positions in many professional societies. Last year, she was the 99th president of the American Medical Women's Association and acted as section editor of the Aesthetic Plastic Surgery Journal. She has been recognized as the Cassius Connolly's top doctor, top surgeon, and best doctors in America since 2009, continuously present. She has received numerous awards, including the Achievement Award from the City of New York, and for her surgical skills, compassion and service, as well as the Hellenic Medical Society Award tonight, which recognizes the contributions of female physicians to medicine. Dr. Eleni Toussinis lives in Georgetown with her husband and her two beautiful young boys, 4 and 6 years old. Now, without further ado, I will welcome Eleni to the podium to present.
Thank you, Eleni. It's very ironic because Eleni joined my previous practice at Weill Cornell, and we have the same first name. So everyone who's non-Greek who meets Eleni, they think that we're either cousins or relatives. But Eleni and I actually, we talked for the first time on the phone last year because we had a patient in common in Washington, D.C. And then we met each other in December in Texas. So this is a new friend as well as a colleague. And I want to say thank you to everyone tonight. I have so many friends here from college, and I have friends from New York City. When I first moved to New York in 2001, I didn't have family in New York, and I had a whole group of friends who really took me in as if they were my family, and some of them are here tonight. They're sitting in the back, so I really appreciate that they came, and it's nice to see old colleagues and my mentor from Washington, D.C. who came up, as well as my parents, and I really want to thank the Hellenic Medical Society Board for giving me this great honor. So. These are just some of my disclosures, but I did want to touch a little bit on two female physicians, because last year as the president of the American Medical Women's Association, I spoke a lot about Elizabeth Blackwell, who was the first female physician in America, and yesterday I was operating and I asked the medical students, who was the first female physician in America? And there was silence, nobody knew, and then this little voice beyond the curtain, the anesthesiologist goes, Elizabeth Blackwell. And so we talked all day yesterday about Elizabeth Blackwell, who is an amazing woman. And that was in 1849 that she got her medical degree. And then, as Stella mentioned, Mary Kalapothakis in 1886 was the first Greek-American physician, female physician. So let me speak a little bit about Elizabeth Blackwell, because she's very interesting. She got her medical degree from actually Hobart College, and that was the only college that would accept her. And basically, when she was applying to medical school, the dean did not know what to do with her, because women were not accepted to medical schools. I mean, this is the 19th century. So the dean said, okay, I'm gonna ask 150 of the male students if it's okay to accept you. And if a single male student says no, you don't come. So the guys thought it was a joke. They were like, is this for real that they're asking us if she can come? And so they all voted yes. So she kind of ended up there by a fluke, and she completely changed the class. Everyone loved her. It was a very hard experience for her, but she really brought the class together, and she was very instrumental in the school. And she actually ended up coming to New York City, and she started a practice on Second Avenue. So she's kind of like an old-time New Yorker, and she started a women's hospital here. So she was noted for her work, and she was also practicing surgical skills as well. And Florence Nightingale really did a big nod to her for all her compassion and her education. But Florence Nightingale did not like that she was trying to train other women to become doctors. So she and Florence Nightingale actually had a falling out. So it was interesting because now it's 1897, and Maria became the first female Greek-American physician, and she was also a surgeon and the director of the Red Cross during the Greco-Turkish War that Stella had mentioned, and she also started a hospital for women and children, and she was also recognized by Florence Nightingale. But by that time, Florence Nightingale had kind of gotten over the whole idea of a woman being a physician, and she didn't hold it against her. And as Stella mentioned, she was known to be very generous and charitable, so it's a great honor to receive an award in her name. So basically, as a little bit of an introduction to myself, I wanted to tell my non-Greek friends what is something that Greeks always say to each other when they meet each other. They always say, apopou ise, which means, where are you from? And my husband is French, and he says the French people don't do this, but the Greek people all do this, and it's a sense of familiarity and commonality. And my mom, who's here tonight, is from the island of Chios, and my father is from Macedonia. He's from a small village called Agras, outside of Edessa, outside of Salonika. And basically, my father came to America in 1947, and he first came in through Hoboken, New Jersey. And he was telling me on the train today, he's like, oh my gosh, I remember coming to Hoboken and how dangerous it was. He said, it's probably not dangerous now. And I said, no, it's beautiful and it's super she-she and it's a whole different place. So from Hoboken, New Jersey, he took a bus to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, where he had answered an ad on the wall of his medical school in Greece for a classics professor who was looking for someone to teach him ancient Greek. And that's how he ended up in Pittsburgh, and he went on to get his PhD from the University of Pittsburgh, and then he continued it at George Washington University in Washington, D.C., and then he did his military duty for Greece in Washington, and that's how my mom and dad and our family ended up in Washington. So I had a very unique childhood that I wanted to share with you, and this is an old photo of my father and I. It's kind of a blurry black and white, but this is when I was 4 years old in 1974, and I'm sitting on my dad's lap, and he's teaching me how to look through the microscope. And I had a unique childhood because my father started a research laboratory in 1963, and it's a family business. This is my mother and father, and they both work together, and they've had this research company for 55 years. So my mom has been very supportive of my father, and I grew up in this research laboratory, the same building here, pretty much most weekends. And I was surrounded by liquid nitrogen and the scanning electron microscope and basically science. And I think that's really what shaped me and how I ended up going to become a doctor. And my father was very, very supportive of me becoming a doctor. He really thought that women as physicians were nurturing and kind and were very skilled. So I appreciate growing up in this environment. So basically today, I'm gonna talk about breast cancer and the incidence and etiology of breast cancer, the environmental influences of breast cancer. And then I'm gonna touch on three areas that I think have really advanced in my field. And my field has really changed, especially in the last 5 to 10 years. I recently met an orthopedic surgeon at a cocktail party, and he said to me, God, our fields haven't changed at all. And I said, oh my gosh, my field has completely revolutionized itself, especially in the last 5 to 10 years. So I really want to share with you three areas that we've changed dramatically for the better. So this is a world map showing the incidence of breast cancer. And as you can see, the highest incidence is in North America, Western Europe, Australia, and South America. It's unknown the reasons for this. They think it's multifactorial, but it's interesting to see where it has the highest incidence. When you look at men and women, the highest incidence of cancers in men is prostate cancer. It's the most common cancer, followed by lung and then colon cancer. In women, the most common is breast cancer, also followed by lung cancer and colon cancer. Now, this is an interesting map. It shows the highest incidence of breast cancer within our country. And this is a fact that I just learned myself a few months ago. I didn't know that Washington, D.C. actually has the highest incidence of breast cancer in the country. It's about 150 cases per 100,000. And as you can see in New York, it's like a medium blue. It's about 120 cases per 100,000 people. They think in Washington, D.C., this has to do with a large African-American population, lower socioeconomics, less access to healthcare, less education. So the causes of breast cancer are many. The majority of cases are sporadic breast cancers, which means that nobody knows what causes the breast cancer. About 25% of patients have familial breast cancer, which means they have a strong family history of breast cancer, but they don't necessarily have the gene. And then about 10% of cases, which is the minority, are the Angelina Jolie patients, the ones that have the BRCA gene and that go on to develop breast cancer. So I'm going to mention some environmental influences that have been associated with breast cancer. I've recently been doing some work with a foundation in San Francisco that focuses solely on environmental influences for getting breast cancer. And they really point to pesticides, DES exposure, and also BPA exposure. So I'm going to talk a little bit about BPA. I'm sure everyone here knows about it because it's in the news quite often. But BPA is bisphenol A, which is a carbon compound that was introduced in 1957. And it's basically what's added to plastic to make it clear and strong. So it's not only in plastic bottles, it's in the sport water bottles, and it's also in the inside lining of cans. So the reason that this is potentially dangerous is that it acts similar to estrogen, and it interferes in the body's hormones. So in 2008, the United States, Canada, and Europe banned it from baby bottles, and they linked it to an increased risk of developing breast, prostate, and brain tumors. So how can we reduce our exposure to BPA? Well, we can seek out products that don't have it, cut back on using foods that are stored in cans, and don't put plastic in the dishwasher or the microwave, and try to use glass, porcelain, stainless steel containers to store your hot foods. So I like this slide because it's something we don't think about. On the bottom of plastic containers, it tells you the number that's a safe number and an unsafe number. So basically 4, 5, 1, and 2, all the rest are not good for you. So we try to avoid plastic that has 3, 6, and 7. So that's something that we don't really pay attention to. But in 2011, the American Medical Association recognized that BPA was a toxin and identified it in consumer products containing BPA. And in 2013, they asked Congress to require manufacturers to provide safety data on these chemicals. So that's really one aspect of causes of breast cancer, which are environmentally linked. Another cause that I mentioned earlier, which is the minority of cases, is the genetic link to breast cancer. And as I mentioned earlier, Angelina Jolie has really brought this out to the forefront and to the spotlight. And the two genes that have been the most studied are the BRCA1 and 2 genes on chromosomes 17 and 13. And as you can see from this bar graph here, in the general population, the risk of developing breast cancer is about 12%. When you have a family history of breast cancer, and if it's a strong one, your risk goes from 12 up to 20%. And when you have the genetic mutation of the BRCA gene, your risk goes up to an 87% lifetime risk that you'll develop breast cancer. So it's a significant jump. So as I was mentioning, I think this was an amazing thing because, I hate to say this, but she almost made breast cancer with mastectomies sexy because she showed that mastectomy nowadays is not the mastectomy of our grandmother and older generations era, which was disfiguring. The reconstruction has become so much better, and she's really brought to the forefront genetic testing, which a lot of people previously didn't know about. So I next want to talk a little bit about prevention. And as we all know, early detection is the key to prevention. So I'm going to talk a little bit about screening mammography, the importance of regular exercise and decreasing alcohol intake, as well as good nutrition and then avoiding toxins such as BPA. So as we all know, the recommendations for screening mammography is that you start at the age of 40 and you have a mammogram every year. Unless you have a strong family history of breast cancer, then you can start at age 35 or 10 years younger than your mother or sister was diagnosed. And it's been interesting for me to leave New York City, where I practiced for 11 years, and going to Washington, D.C., where Washington has a different medical culture, and some doctors actually don't follow these guidelines, which are the American Cancer Society guidelines. They actually follow the United States Preventative Task Force guidelines, which don't recommend mammograms until 50 and mammograms every 2 years. So unfortunately, I see a lot of women that haven't had a mammogram in 10 years, and they're really presenting with very advanced disease, which is very different from what I saw in New York City, where women are being followed very closely and being very highly screened and coming in with small cancers. And from a surgeon's standpoint, it does make a big difference, because when you have a large tumor, we can't offer you as many options. So this is very important, close screening.
Can you just tell us, in 1 second, why you think the United States Preventive Health Task Force may never?
Well, it was basically a non-biased group. You know, there's a lot of cost savings that they're looking for. I know that now with gynecology, with the pap smear recommendations, they're giving new recommendations about that. So basically, you know, they had a group of physicians that were not breast cancer specialists, and they looked at the data, and they wanted to make sure that they were catching enough cancers and not causing too many unnecessary procedures. Because the downside of screening so closely is that you're going to find a lot of, you know, false positives and lead to a lot of unnecessary biopsies. So that's why their recommendation came forward. But a lot of people now have extended that recommendation, and they're not even really recommending mammograms so frequently. And being in a different medical environment, and I'm seeing this, most women don't get followed closely anymore because of those new recommendations. And the interesting thing is, in the medical schools, they're actually testing them on the United States Preventive Task Force, which I didn't know. I thought they were following the Cancer Society, but they're actually quizzing the students based on the government recommendation. So this is a slide that I show all my patients, and now I'm going to switch to the first of three advances that I want to talk about. And the first one has to do with mastectomy and the changing ways that we do mastectomy now. There's two different options that patients have when they're diagnosed with breast cancer. They can either remove the breast, which is a mastectomy, have their skin envelope reconstructed, or they can save the breast and have a lumpectomy, which is followed by whole breast radiation. So the first advance I'm going to talk about is nipple sparing mastectomy, which we've been practicing probably for the past 10 years, and I'd say it's become very popular in the past 5 years. But it also depends on where you live in the United States. I was actually just in Atlanta, Georgia last week, and they're not doing a lot of this. So it depends on where you are in the country. In New York City, a lot of the surgeons here have been doing this technique for a long time. The importance when you're comparing mastectomy to lumpectomy and counseling patients about what to decide is I always tell my patients, it doesn't matter whether you remove your breast or save your survival is the same. The only thing that's a little bit different is your chance of the tumor coming back in the same breast is a little bit higher after lumpectomy, and I tell my patients it's about a 7% chance it can come back in 10 years after lumpectomy and radiation, versus about a 1% chance it can come back in 10 years after mastectomy. And women are really smart, and they want to know, why is there any chance that my tumor can come back when you remove my breast? And the answer is, it's not possible for any surgeon to remove 100% of the breast tissue. The breast tissue actually sticks to the skin. And if we as surgeons scrape the breast tissue off the skin will die. So we always leave a very thin layer of residual breast tissue under the skin. So even after mastectomy, even though the woman doesn't need imaging anymore, she still comes back to see us just to check the skin. So it's also interesting to see what percentage of women are choosing mastectomy and lumpectomy. In Washington, D.C., this is our numbers from Georgetown, it's about 50-50. And when I was in New York City, it was 30% chose mastectomy, 70% chose lumpectomy. I actually think that this is a national trend, that more women are choosing mastectomy. And it's because they want to decrease the risk of the tumor coming back by as much as possible. The reconstruction has gotten so much better, and it's not as disfiguring as it was before. And also because of the genetic testing and the use of MRI, women are opting to do mastectomy. And it's not only mastectomy, but they're also opting to remove the opposite breast, which is the healthy breast, for symmetry and for peace of mind. So this is a picture of a woman with no reconstruction, and so you can see a very long scar, and it's completely flat, versus a woman that's had something called a skin-sparing mastectomy, which we started doing in the 1980s. And that means that we remove the nipple and the ring around the nipple, save all the skin, and remove the breast tissue from underneath, and then reconstruct the breast with either an implant or some fat from the tummy. So within the last 5 to 10 years, this is a nipple-sparing mastectomy. I tell my husband that I feel like I spend my day at work trying to explain to women that even though this looks like a boob job, it is not a boob job, because you're still losing your body part, and you still have lack of sensation from here all the way down to here. So the way that we do this, and I'm going to show you some pictures, and this is actually a New York patient of mine, Dr. Sherman, who just left, was the reconstructive surgeon, and she was a typical New York woman. As you can see, she's got no body fat, she's a triathlete, she's married with 4 kids, and she's a hedge fund manager. So Dr. Sherman and I operated on her, and 5 days later, I remember she flew out to Jackson Hole, Wyoming with her drains to go to a board meeting. So this was like a very, you know, doer type person, but you can see she had an excellent result. So I'm going to show you some pictures. If you don't want to look, there's nothing gory, but if you don't want to look, you can look away. But this is a patient of mine, and she's getting marked right before the surgery. We do all the surgery through the bra line. So we actually make a marking pen here, right under the bra line, so the patient won't be able to see the incision. And then during the surgery, we actually save the nipple, the areola, and all the overlying skin, and remove the breast tissue underneath. So there's basically just this remaining skin envelope. And then a plastic surgeon comes in and puts either an implant into this empty space, or then takes some fat from their tummy and move it up into this space. So this is the patient after the surgery, and you can see it's an amazing cosmetic result compared to the previous types of reconstruction, where either the women didn't get any reconstruction or had their muscles removed or large scars. So psychologically, this is a huge improvement because she's improved her visual aspect, her body image, and it has increased patient satisfaction. So let me talk a little bit about how lumpectomy has now advanced. Because traditionally, the way we used to do lumpectomy is we'd remove the tumor, check the lymph nodes, and then treat the whole breast, the remaining breast, with 4 to 6 weeks of radiation. So Stella's a radiation doctor. I was hoping there was going to be no radiation doctors here tonight, because I'm going to show the downsides of radiation. And as we all know, that radiation treatments, it's about 30 treatments. It can be very time consuming, can be expensive, and there's many possible side effects. We worry about injury to the heart on the left-hand side, as well as lung injury, because inevitably a little bit of the heart and lung can be irradiated. There can be skin breakdown and secondary cancers. So this is a diagram showing the beam of the radiation, and it's treating the breast, but it's also getting this tiny sliver of the heart and lung underneath. And this is a picture of some of the burns that can happen from radiation after the treatment. They usually go away, but as you can imagine, they're very painful and uncomfortable. And one of the complications from radiation that's very uncommon but can happen and carries a high mortality is a secondary cancer called angiosarcoma. And this is actually a picture of an angiosarcoma, and it appears as little purplish blisters on the skin. So one of the advances in radiation is doing more targeted partial breast radiation, whereas instead of radiating this large area, including a little bit of the lung and a little bit of the heart on the left and the whole breast, we're actually targeting the radiation to only where the tumor is located. And I actually spent a year in Italy learning this technique with Dr. Veronese, and this was about 12 years ago. So the Europeans are actually more advanced with this technology than the Americans. And in 2010, the Europeans published their data on this targeted radiation, showing that if you gave one dose of radiation to this one area, it was equal to the 30 doses of radiation. So we call it one and done, because it's done during the surgery, and it replaces those 30 doses of radiation. Because it's a very limited and targeted radiation, it's very well tolerated with less side effects. But basically, this is the inventor of the intrabeam targeted radiation. His name's Jay Vaida, and I met him in New York City about 10 years ago, and this guy is a Doogie Howser. When I introduced him to a lecture at Georgetown, his resume started at age 8 with his first novel. So this guy is incredible. And he lives in London, and this was his PhD dissertation in 1991. And then basically he started the clinical trial and the data was published in 2010. And it was a multi-institutional prospective randomized trial showing that the two treatments were equal. So in 2010, when that data was published, many of the American hospitals got on board and we started using it at Cornell in 2012. And currently there's 55 hospitals in the country. So when I came down to Washington, D.C., I did the first case in 2013. And we've treated about 60 women with no recurrences in the past 2 years. We were one of 8 hospitals chosen to be on a national US registry to follow these patients long-term to see how they do. And we're included in the Cleveland Clinic retrospective review, also looking at how these patients are doing. And we just published a quality of life study on our first 60 patients, looking at the cosmesis, the patient satisfaction, as well as the local recurrence rate. And the results have been excellent. So the last advance I want to talk about is breast analgesia after breast surgery. And before I had had children, I had a really hard time seeing my patients after they had surgery in the recovery room because they were in such pain. And I was always worried I was going to overdose them with too much medication. So I told myself, don't go to see them in the recovery room because it's just going to upset me. So I then had 2 kids. And I was so amazed with the epidural. I thought, oh my God, whoever invented this epidural deserves the Peace Prize. It was such a beautiful thing. So when I came back from maternity leave, I started giving my patients an epidural for mastectomy. And it was amazing. My patients could not feel anything. They were completely numb from up here to down here. The epidural was removed the next day, and they had an amazing recovery. So I had a special anesthesiologist, and she was trained only in blocks, so I had no complications. But then when I moved to Washington, D.C., I didn't know the anesthesiologist, and with the thoracic epidural, a high epidural, you have to be very specially trained because there can be complications. So luckily, there was a new drug that came out that I'm gonna talk to you about, which is basically similar to Novocaine, but it lasts for 3 days. And so I use that instead, and I'm a big fan of it. So just to talk about analgesia for breast surgery, there's something about breast surgery that's different from other surgeries. It can be extremely painful, and women that have breast surgery have a very high risk of having postoperative nausea and vomiting. It's about 50%. And they don't know why in the breast surgery patient population it's higher than the other patient population, but that's half of our patients wake up with nausea and vomiting. So, and this pain after the surgery in some patients can persist for an entire year. So, if you give them inadequate pain control after the surgery, it actually increases the patient's time that they spend in the recovery room. It results in longer hospital stays. It decreases their quality of life. And you end up having to use increased narcotics, which result in other complications like constipation or addiction in some cases. And it increases healthcare costs. So that's where this medication comes forward. And I'm a huge fan of this medication. I consider it inexpensive, it's $280, but I was just talking to this group in Georgia last week and they said $280, we won't be able to afford that in our hospital. So, you know, price is relative where you're coming from. You know, I compare it to an epidural, which is $2,000 to $3,000 between the anesthesia fee and the other fees and maintaining the catheter. I love this because I inject it during the surgery while the patient's asleep and it basically lasts for 3 days and it has no complications. So this drug is called Exparel. And it's basically bupivacaine, which is attached to a fatty molecule called a liposome, which is very bulky. So when you inject it, it doesn't travel anywhere. It just sits in place for 3 days. And this is actually a photograph, a scanning electron micrograph of the fatty molecule. And it's FDA approved. There's been about 10 studies looking at this drug, and it's basically reduced the pain score in the first 3 days after surgery by 30%. And in half of the patients, it's decreased their opioid consumption. So I find that the results with this are excellent. Patients are going home very fast and having excellent recoveries. It really makes a difference. So in conclusion, breast cancer is very common. Most of the breast cancer cases are from unknown causes. Genetic testing has really come into the forefront and is really gonna be the wave of the future. And even though it's a minority of patients, the woman who identified the BRCA gene, Mary Claire King, was just speaking in Texas, and she basically says that she is advocating that all women get genetically tested. So I think this is going to be something we're going to be seeing more commonly amongst our patient population. Screening is important for early detection. The surgical options have improved, and the trend is toward more minimally invasive treatment with less side effects. So I'd like to give a special thanks to my mentors here, Dr. Florence Hazelton, and she's photographed here with her brother, Bill Hazelton. And they're both incredible scientists and physicians. I was friends with Florence's brother, Bill, in New York City. And then he introduced me to Florence right when I had moved down to DC. And Florence has been a huge mentor to me, a friend and a colleague. So I really appreciate that she came up from Washington for this, as well as, thanks Florence, as my mother and father, and my two brothers, my sister Maria, and my husband Rafael, and my two sons, Alex, Alexandros, and Lucas, who are pictured here.
Thank you, Eleni. Thank you for the wonderful, very comprehensive presentation for what it is, the definitive therapy for breast cancer. I will continue to talk to you about another aspect of the multidisciplinary care, very important as well in the treatment of breast cancer. Which is the view from the medical oncology. Know that the other cancer drug development remains slow, costly, and ineffective. And post-definitive surgery is very important to understand that our only chance and our final test to cure breast cancer is in the adjuvant setting, instituting post-operative treatment. And it has taken almost 30 years since Bonandona introduced the first adjuvant chemotherapy regimen, CMF, to advance therapy with the introduction of the anthracyclines and taxanes, and subsequent endocrine therapy in the post-operative setting. And we're not quite there because the adjuvant setting, the post-operative treatment setting, is a very challenging model to advance drug discovery. The effect is hypothetical and the toxicity is very concrete. And given the long natural history of the disease, it takes many years to evaluate the effect of therapy. And these protracted timelines might include almost 10 to 15 years for us to define optimal therapies for breast cancer. The classification of breast cancer has evolved from the initial histologic subtypes, and with the technological advances, our conceptual framework in drug development has advanced the biological platform. And this has been mainly facilitated by the recognition through gene profiling technologies that have defined four intrinsic subtypes of the disease. And these subtypes reflect the biologic heterogeneity of the disease. So patients with the same stage of the disease and the same, almost same pathology report might have totally different outcomes. And it is this biologic heterogeneity that reflects the clinical heterogeneity of the disease. And as you see here from these curves, the blue and the yellow line reflect two different outcomes in terms of survival post-definitive surgery with no further therapy, and they represent the two ends of the spectrum of the hormone receptor positive disease. In this slide, you see the degree of differentiation as the sum of the continuum of biologic aberration. And as this differentiation increases, this corresponds to decreased proliferation and increase in the estrogen dependence. So we know that high proliferative tumors, that they have low degree of differentiation, they respond better to chemotherapy, whereas tumors that are highly differentiated, on the other side, side of the spectrum, they're the ones that they respond to the endocrine therapy. Of these, some of biologic aberrations complicate the landscape and the way we approach the disease and the heterogeneity of the disease. We look for a common denominator, and the only one is heterogeneity. And there are several questions that they need to be answered at the early stages of the disease, of the way we approach therapy in the early stages of the disease, and the way we approach therapy at the advanced stages. Among these questions, the most important is how we approach the clonal evolution. What is the importance of the driver mutations? How we can capture these driver mutations? And which clones are really important and they play a major role in the lethal outcome of the disease? Some light has been shed to elucidate the heterogeneity of the disease with mixed laboratory data. Gene profiling expression has dissected disease of aggressive biology in several subtypes. Copy number transcriptome analysis has segregated the disease to the one of low genomic instability and to the one with high genomic instability with lots of aberrations that we're referring to the p53, whereas in the low genomic instability group, we do see a lot of aberrations to the PI3 kinase pathway. More importantly, the next generation sequencing technology is defining the mutational landscape. And at Vanderbilt University, investigators, they were able to work with 21 breast cancer data sets, almost 600 cases, and were able to define multiple types for the same subgroup of breast cancer patients with aggressive biology, what we call triple negative disease. So we do see that among these four initially defined intrinsic subtypes, we are now recognizing further subdivisions. The same investigators were able to identify the driver pathways for each of these subtypes and work with preclinical models, testing different therapies, targeting specifically these driver pathways. And the results from these preclinical experiments inform currently ongoing clinical trials. The anxiety of whether these driver pathways are really actionable has been relieved in part by work done again at Vanderbilt University. They have been very active, where the investigators were able to do next generation sequencing and define the most recurrently altered genes, representing amplifications, deletions, rearrangements, and non-somatic mutations at the residual component of breast cancer after completing preoperative chemotherapy. And they were able to identify five main pathways that are potentially targetable. Among them, the PI3 kinase pathway, and I'm focusing on this because we do have available therapies, and the DNA repair pathway as well. This is more detailed information about the work that has been done. In the context of the discussion that we had before for the BRCA testing, this slide here shows the change from the old model when the testing of the drugs was from the compound to the patients to what now focuses on patient selection based on specific abnormality, on specific vulnerability. Among these vulnerabilities is the BRCA mutant status for the patients, and luckily enough for these patients, we do have targeted therapy, what we call PARP inhibitors that have created a lot of excitement and are currently in development in the phase 3 clinical trial setting. so exploiting the concept of synthetic lethality, which basically what the DRC income establishment means. It means that the cancer cell is disabled to repair DNA damage because the molecular recombination component is not working by disabling another major mechanism of DNA repair in the basic lesion repair system. The cancer cell is disabled entirely to repair the DNA damage caused by cytotoxic chemotherapy. The exciting prospects of learning more about the biology of the disease is that we can now start designing clinical trials to target functionally implicated pathways in breast cancer, with priority to immunomodulation, drug development, and all of biologically rational combinations, antagonizing the feedback loops of the MEK inhibitors to sorafenib, or creating conditions of synthetic lethality, the path inhibition with other targeted therapy. And not in the very far future, but a lot of effort is focusing on metabolomics as well. This slide here basically shows experiments in preclinical models where a state of synthetic lethality has been tested, and the vulnerability with combination of therapies, where we see that combinations of specific agents can be extremely effective. This data in preclinical models mutant for the DRC mutation, or sporadic triple-negative disease where we don't have the DRC mutation, but still there is a state of BRCAness. And if there is no state of BRCAness, how this can be created by treating these models with PI3 kinase inhibition that causes the same level of genomic instability. This trial work has led already to a phase 1 clinical trial. But what is really very exciting is that the drug development now is moving upfront. From the initial metastatic models where patients had been treated with several therapies, and a lot of them that were heavily treated, not treatment naive, with advanced performance status, it was really very challenging to proceed with optimal drug development and discovery. And then in the adjuvant setting, I spoke to you before about the challenges of the protracted timeline, and especially given the challenge of enrolling unselected patients. Now we do have the opportunity to utilize the pre-operative platform, not only in the locally advanced disease setting, but also for smaller tumors with aggressive biology before they go and have definitive surgery with all these amazing sophisticated techniques. The pre-operative treatment setting enables us to obtain new specimens and proceed with what we call translational research, run precision medicine analysis with next generation sequencing or other sophisticated technologies used in the laboratory to define biomarkers for treatment selection and individualized therapy. So, the neoadjuvant concept has evolved from the initial indication for locally advanced disease, which was inoperable, to optimize and downstage the disease and optimize conditions for breast conserving surgery to provide now a very invaluable platform for drug testing and correlative studies. And multidisciplinary groups came up with standard definitions for neoadjuvant treatment of therapeutic intent, where the aim is to optimize the pathologic complete response rate. We do have cases that they receive preoperative chemotherapy and the disease is completely resolved. These patients will go ahead and have surgery, of course, and receive all the local, the optimal local control, but excitingly enough, we do know that pathological complete response in the aggressive biology disease setting is associated with optimal outcome. We also have the opportunity to run what we call pre-surgical, biological window of opportunity trials. These are very short course interventions where we aim to define biomarkers. As a successful example for expected drug development in the neoadjuvant treatment setting is the recently approved HER2 doublet therapy, the pertuzumab, with impressive reported pathologic complete response rate up to 60%. This is very important because for these women until 2005, we basically had very limited options, and we in less than a decade, we do have approved three drugs for HER2 doublet therapy. In this schema here, I can show you what we call an add-on clinical trial design, where standard preoperative therapy is combined with target therapy, novel therapeutics. We have done it, optimizing pathological complete response rate. Another aspect of this window of opportunity interventions to proceed with investigational therapy, short course therapy, before definitive surgical resection. Very important for correlative studies. I have personally worked with this in collaboration with colleagues from Columbia University, and who are able to successfully show what we call target suppression, target modulation, which is very important because to know that we're able to evaluate the biologic effect of this therapy. But the real question is, what is the real effect of these targeted therapies, of any investigational therapy, on the cell fate of the cancer cell? And in order to obtain this, we are coming in agreement that what we need is organized biospecimen repository protocols. It's an organized effort, it's a multidisciplinary effort, where I personally took the initiative when I was at Montefiore, and now we continue this at Cornell to obtain consecutive biopsies in the preoperative treatment setting and collaborate with scientists in the laboratory in order to interrogate the effect of the testing therapies on the cancer cells. And this schema here shows the processing of these biospecimens from the collaborative groups, either these are the radiologists or the surgeons to obtain the biopsy, and all these are channeled in different laboratories who are focusing on answering specific questions and interrogating very important issues in breast cancer medicine, drug resistance, the process of the metastasis as well. So as you see here, the effect of chemotherapy is not always what we anticipate with cell death. There are conditions as accelerated senescence that in the past was perceived as a positive outcome, but we do now recognize that these cells at some stage and point, they transform and they start proliferate. And it's very important to make sure that we do not induce these states of cell fate that they will be detrimental and deleterious for the outcome of our patients, of course. Of course, in a normal organism, the immune system is clearing the senescent cells, but in the state of cancer, these cells can be harbored and be transformed later on and manifest as metastatic disease. In the preoperative treatment setting, for patients who are treated with standard therapy and they still have clinically detectable disease, we have an enormous opportunity to run clinical trials because for these reasons we know that the outcome will be unfavorable and there is no standard therapy in the adjuvant setting. And this is what our focus is. this biologically aggressive residual disease, that is hemoresistant to what has been our standard therapy. For this particular research, we're proposing interventions with combination therapy, and here is what Sophia has mentioned before, by knowing that this species are BRCA mutant, they have a specific vulnerability, we feel, of course, more comfortable going ahead and instituting target therapy available. What is going to be more exciting is when we find ourselves in a position to intervene upfront with therapies that they will prevent the unfavorable fate. They will prevent the induction of conditions like senescence, and this will enable optimal therapy to act and cause what is the optimal outcome, which is cell death for the cancer cells. So what we have to do is to evolve our mindset, and this and our practice has to focus on redefining the molecular signatures at different time points during the disease evolution. There are changes in the tumor cell and the tumor microenvironment, and the disease is evolving from the earlier stages to the advanced stages. The disease is in a dynamic status. This dynamic status is characterized by enormous diversity, and this diversity influences the phenotype and cost sensitivity to treatment. The concept of cell fate and molecular dependencies should be addressed and interrogated at multiple time points. Biomarker-driven clinical trials is what will facilitate and accelerate drug development. And all this needs a very strong collaboration within all the disciplines involved in breast cancer medicine, with major players being the surgeons, of course, radiologists, medical oncologists, radiation oncologists, pathologists, but we do need patients' advocate groups to facilitate this process by participating in what seems to be the future for precision medicine. I thank you all very much. Thank you.
Distinction is important. I'm a radiologist, I'm a primary practitioner. My job, medical director of Lancet Radiology, we're a big group, but my job is really to try to look at the new technologies coming out and see how they can best help us take care of patients. The lecture I wanted to talk to you, I'm sure you said, is it's interesting that there are parallels between breast care, breast imaging, and prostate imaging. The prostate gland, breast gland, people have been using mammography for decades to analyze the breast. Prostate has been imaged only in the last 15 years or so using MR. There hasn't been any good way to image it. It was a physical examination and a poor examination at that. It's a finger feeling the back of the gland. A breast exam, you can feel all of the breast tissue. The prostate is deep in the body, and it really wasn't until MR came around that people were able to take a look at the gland and to see inside of the gland. The MR technology and for breast and for prostate was all about anatomy initially. And breast scientists, no, not a scientist, I'm just a clinician, developed techniques to look at the blood flow through breast tissue. Those techniques eventually carried over to prostate. So I was just going to give you just a background, the background of prostate imaging. Why do you use MR? It's a screening tool primarily for high-risk patients, and high-risk being an elevated PSA. You can use it to treat a gland, you can use it for somebody who's refusing the standard traditional approach for screening prostate cancer, which is a blind biopsy. Now, if you imagine doing blind biopsies for breast cancer as a screening tool, it would be kind of strange. And I grew up in an era of prostate MR, so I think it's very odd that men get blind biopsies of their prostate glands. So the concept of screening high-risk patients with breast MR has really developed over the last few years based upon the technology that I'll be showing you. The literature supports that the new techniques for prostate MR can adequately distinguish between high-risk cancers and other pathology, low-risk prostatitis. There's new technology to allow the ultrasound-guided biopsies that urologists do, which traditionally have been blind, to be actually targeted utilizing fusion technology, MR and ultrasound. And then, of course, patients are finding this information out on their own and demanding it. So the expression for prostate MR in today's world is multi-parametric imaging. It uses the first two here are the T1 and the T2 are anatomy. The CAD is the blood flow sequences that I was talking about that were initially developed for breast imaging. And then the diffusion-weighted imaging is a technology that's been developing and it's really the cornerstone of this talk and these technologies. So diffusion-weighted imaging is a way of looking at how tightly packed cells are. If cells are loosely arranged, there's free water moving between them, and that's a very normal physiologic state. When cells are very tightly packed, such as what you have in a cancer, there's very little water surrounding the cells, and those water, the water's movement is restricted, and the restriction can be seen as an MR signal. So going back to 20 years ago, what we did with prostate MR, we had an adder. And this is a anatomical analysis of the prostate gland. This is an arrow. So you can see the normal peripheral gland, which cancers are usually found in the prostate gland. This is the central transitional gland, and this is the bladder. And the prostate gland here is bulging to the base of the bladder. These are the seminal vesicles. And you can see this is a very normal looking gland without a lesion. This is the breast MR. It uses the technology of contrast flowing through the breast tissue. And the areas that are bright, in this case the green, are showing rapid wash in and wash out of contrast material, which denotes a suspicious area within the breast and has a high risk for being a breast cancer. That technology was applied to prostate imaging. And you can see here that this is a very normal-looking prostate gland without any abnormal signals. Is the just some motion of the seminal vesicle. But here you see the peripheral gland is very normal. Blue is just sort of a rapid, slow progressive enhancement, which is what one would hope to see. This is abnormal enhancement within the central gland. And people had hoped that this technology would be parallel to the technologies of breast imaging, where the rapid wash-in and wash-out would relate to a breast cancer. In this case, it related to some type of change within the prostate gland, but it wasn't a necessarily a high-grade prostate cancer. It wasn't a prostate cancer necessarily that anybody wanted to treat. It could also represent a small focus of central glandular hyperplasia, benign, or even prostatitis. So it was completely non-specific and not very useful. This is just a close-up, so you can see this area here. This is maybe a cancer, I don't know. This is the enhancement pattern that is so very non-specific. So along comes diffusion-weighted imaging, and it really sort of gets going in early 2000s. The technology, as I described, it's a fast sequence, about 5 minutes, and it really helps us see where cells are tightly packed. So this is a case. If you look at the date here, I'd like you to look at the date 2012. We're using a 1.5 Tesla magnet for this scan. And the, for those of you who are physicians, the strength of the magnet has to do with how much signal you have. So what we're using now is a pre-tested magnet. The 1.5s are an earlier version. On this, in this case, this is a compilation picture, but you see the anatomy. Here there are two lesions. Both of these lesions demonstrate rapid washing and wash out of contrast. And here you see that only one lesion has the restricted diffusion, which is seen as white on this picture. And so here you can, moving through, and you can really see that both lesions were present on the anatomy view, but on the diffusion, this new technique that we have available to us, you see that one is white, and that ends up being a high-grade cancer. And we biopsied it, we do an MRI guided biopsy, stuck a needle in it, it was cancer, the person had the prostate treated. So here's another cancer. This is, I want to see the date here, this is 2013. This is a 3-Tesla magnet, but it's an earlier version, 3-Tesla magnet than what we're using today. And here you see the anatomy, nice dark lesion. It's got the rapid washing and washout of contrast material. And again, on the diffusion, we see this restricted. So here's a recent case, just last couple weeks. Here's the diffusion. Now, I want you to just look at how sharp the margins are of the prostate gland and how clean the dark is. It helps me bring my eye to this area over here. I want you to go back to the case that I just showed you, and I want you to see how grainy this and how irregular the margins are. Today, here's the case from 2012, and although we made the diagnosis, it's kind of fuzzy. It's not clear, it's not easy to see. Again, sharp margins, irregular margins. This is the anatomy picture. You can see that there's a tumor here. So we went ahead and we biopsied it, and it was Gleason 7. It had neurovascular invasion. I just want you to, the history here was the patient had a rising PSA, the patient had a blind biopsy, no cancer came back. 6 months later, patient had another blind biopsy, no cancer came back. PSA keeps on going up. The patient came to us, we did an MR, and we were able to get the patient treated. Now, multiparametric imaging has been accepted for prostate. And what about breast? There's currently an Akron trial going on to look at diffusion-weighted imaging in breast. It's a big study, lots of patients, and it's very promising that the diffusion will be able to be used in breast. People have been doing it for a while in an experimental model, but if you look at the images that I showed you, the technology improved so dramatically that we're saying that fields have changed over the last 10 years. I got out of training in 2003. I don't do anything today that I learned about when I graduated. Everything I do is new. And it's just, to me, the concept of diffusion is old or years old, but the techniques that are used to acquire the images and the machines themselves are improving dramatically. And what does this mean? You know, if this Akron shows what preliminary shows study suggests, for us, for a clinician, it means 5 more minutes for the patient on the table. It means there's, you'll markedly reduce the false positives that MR, MR is traditionally been shied away from. People are scared to use it because it shows you all these different red marks all over the breast, and so many of them are false positives that you use to biopsies and second look ultrasounds. Now with diffusion, you can decrease that dramatically because you can just toss a bunch of off the table. So because you're tossing things off the table, a lot of patients don't even have to come for a second look. And that's important. I'm a clinician and I don't get the second look ultrasound. But I think that that's, you know, this is a good thing. That this is expedites care. And it's, what is it? It's 5 more minutes on the MR magnet. It's a 25-minute exam that now is a half an hour exam. And when there is a lesion on breast MR, the focused ultrasound is more targeted. So women get a more dedicated exam, and people are paying more attention to the right spot. So that's my evolving field. Thank you.
Thank you to our speakers, Dr. Lamaris, for putting it together, and thank you for our sponsors, Lenox Hill Radiology, and also the Katz-Witten Foundation. Thank you very much. Good night.
To all the new doctors out there, please get involved. We wait for your involvement. We urge your involvement. We encourage your involvement. And we need your help. Definitely, we are here. We want to show the community that doctors care. Doctors care about the community. And this is one of the platforms that we can do that. So far, it's 2015. We've already had multiple opportunities for doctors to showcase themselves, to speak to the community, and to get their practices, their education, and some even vital information out to patients. Please get involved. We need your help. We want your help. And the community would love to see you. That concludes our Mary Kalopotakis Symposium for 2015. We hope that everyone here learned something, as I did as well, and we hope that we continue to have speakers like this in the future. On May 3rd, we will have another talk at the Cathedral Church on 77th Street in New York City. The talk will be on the importance of mental health, and there will be a panel of psychologists and psychiatrists talking to the community about their involvement and encouraging others to get involved. Our next event will be held May 12th, the Papanikolaou Symposium and the Scholarship Award at the Cornell Weill New York Hospital Medical Center. And thank you most of all to NGTV for being here with us, getting our message out, and helping the community as always.
NGTV USA. Οι δραστηριότητες της ελληνοαμερικανικής κοινότητας με βίντεο και πλήρες ρεπορτάζ. Επισκεφτείτε την ιστοσελίδα μας mgtvusa.com.